We'll be going through the epic of Kālidāsa, epic written by Kālidāsa called Kumāra Sambhavam. Before I go into the details of the epics of this particular epic, I would like to draw a comparison between the two epics that we have seen so far, that of Vyāsa, that of Vālmīki, and the one which we are going to see, which Shashi is going to talk about, and I too will continue, the Raghuvamsha. We are going to cover four epics during this 10-day workshop. And what is the difference and commonality between the four that is to be seen? Like Ganesh has been mentioning since morning, Ramayana is of a particular person. The journey, the travel is not merely physical, it is emotional and spiritual travel of Rama. That is Ramayana, a family man. Him, his wife, his brother, and the associated people. That is the Ramayana, the epic of a person and his family. The Raghu Vamsha is of a Vamsha, of a lineage. It's not just of one family, it's a series of families, generations. Nearly 19 generations of kings have been delineated in the Raghu Vamsha. More than 19, I think, have been dealt. Like the name itself says. So Ayana is travel of a person, Vamsha, the lineage of Raghu, and Mahabharata, the whole space of Bharata. That is what Mahabharata deals with. And this one, what I'm going to talk about is Kumara Sambhava. It is for the birth of Kumara, for the birth of son. It is very specific. So Vyasa's is the largest canvas where he deals about an entire civilization. Raghuvamsha of a lineage, of a particular lineage. Ramayana of a particular person, a family man. And Kumara Sambhava of a person, which is Shiva. And associated with him is Parvati. So these are the four epics that we'll be dealing in the 10-day workshop. There are some commonalities. I would like to deviate a bit and say something about the ancient epics, not just of Indian origin, written by Vyasa and Valmiki, but those of the Greek or Roman origin too. You would all have noticed that travel to different places is one of the prominent features in all our epics. In Ramayana, we know that Rama has been traveling from Ayodhya to Sri Lanka and he goes back. That's there. Most of Ramayana is Rama's travel, and Ramayana itself means the travel of Rama. And in Mahabharata, a large part, the Vanaparva, which is of 324 sargas, is being devoted to their travel in the forest. This is similar with Odyssey of Homer and Aeneid of Virgil. Odyssey today is a synonym for travel. They are epic poets of the Western tradition, and they have laid the foundation for all the future artwork that developed in the West. So there is travel associated with Odysseus there, the hero, and Aeneid has the travels of Aeneas. So why is it that our epic poets have been so haunted by travel? Why did they take up this travel as their main theme in all their epics? Even to this day, whenever we want to travel to another place, there would be a sense of excitement, a sense of fear. We don't know what we are going to encounter, what is the different culture, and what the people there would be in an alien land that we are going to. And there would be excitement, there would be fear, wonder, joy, and also pain due to separation from our homelands. So these are the different kinds of emotions a person will undergo when he's traveling to a different place. So these are the very emotions that act as the raw material for the poets. So the poets have been dealing with universal human emotions. Today, time and space have been decreased due to the advancement in technology. Travel has become safe, travel has become faster, and all that. But imagine the times of Vyasa, Valmiki, Homer, and Virgil, where travel was such a dangerous thing. A person's very identity was at risk. You never know if he's going to come back home safe. And when you go to another place, your very own identity is at stake. I know people in Bangalore or people in my friends group know me that I'm Arjun, I have this background, I'm doing this. When I go to an alien land, they don't even know me. I need to introduce myself and I'm an alien there, and there's an identity crisis. These are the things that have subconsciously bothered the ancient mind, have been consciously made use of by the poets. And what more, when the heroes, so Rama is the hero, he is removed from his home, When the heroes are removed from their homes, the poet will get an opportunity to describe what's happening back home. What is Bharata doing? Similarly, when Odysseus is removed from his home, he has gone onto the Trojan War. The Greeks have won the Trojan War. I won't elaborate the story. And he's on his way back home, which took him more than 10 years to come back. And when he's away from his home, we see what happens to your kingdom when the king is away. What happens to his wife who is there back at home? The Pativratya, the devotion of Penelope to her husband Odysseus, is only seen because Odysseus is removed from her. Or else this character wouldn't have developed at all. What happens to Odysseus' father, Laertes? All these things we'll be able to see because the heroes are removed from their hometowns. And the travels and the travails that the heroes undergo when they visit alien lands and alien cultures, that is one more thing which we are, of course, able to get to know when the heroes are removed from their native places. And of course, it gives a bigger geographical canvas for the poets to paint their poetic picture on. It's a huger canvas. Imagine if you were just sitting at home, if Rama was just sitting at home, would so many turmoils and emotions, would they have happened? Would Sita have been kidnapped? None of these would have happened. So the importance of travel is seen there. And because Pandavas, for whatever reason, their own mistake or the mistake of the Kauravas, for whatever reason, they were exiled. And the exile that they went through, they used it for honing their skills. Arjuna goes to get the Pashupatastra, and in their Ajnatavasa, they make friends with Virata and their family, and several things. So they make alliances and make use of them during the war, during the Kurukshetra war. One major difference, there are many major differences between the travel in Indian epics and the Greek or Roman epics. One is the travel in the Indian epics is mainly on the land. All these people are going to the forests, but in the Greco-Roman epics, it's on the seas. In the Greco-Roman epics, they are in a constant fight with the nature. They want to conquer, they want to win over the nature and reach their destination to achieve a specific means. So their onward journey from Greece to Troy was to bring back a woman who was kidnapped. And the return journey of Odysseus is to go back to his home. There's a specific purpose. So the means of travel has an end, has a different end. But the means of travel here is an end to itself. Rama didn't go to forest to achieve something else. Going to the forest was the desired activity that he carried out. Similarly with Pandavas. And in addition to that, they gained some things. That's a different thing. They made use of the opportunity of staying in the forest to hone their skills and all that. Here, the forest welcomes the heroes and the heroes reciprocate emotionally to the forest. Whereas in the Greek or Roman tradition, it's a fight with the nature which they have to overcome. In the Indian tradition, the travel is with the families. Family of Rama, of course, Rama, Lakshmana and Sita go. And it's the family of the Pandavas accompanied by an entourage of Brahmins and some sages who give them spiritual guidance and advice and all that. It's with the families here, and the travel is an end in itself. But in the Greco-Roman tradition, it's the warriors who are at sea for a fight, for a specific purpose. And in the Indian tradition, they observe austerity, like Ganeshji was mentioning. Rama and Sita didn't have any physical contact. It was only the emotional contact that they had. Whereas there, in the Greco-Roman tradition, Odysseus and his warriors go and ransack every possible place that they get. And they drink, they marry, and all that. That is human nature. This is also human nature. So, two sides. So, why I have been saying all this is, the two ancient epics of India, Ramayana and Mahabharata, the two ancient epics of the Greco-Roman tradition, the Odyssey and the Aeneid, have focused a large part on travel, and travel has added richness to the rasa. So you get Shrungara there, you get Veera, Adbhuta, Bibhatsa, Bhayanaka, and all that. If they were in the vicinity of only their homes and hometown, all these wouldn't have come about, probably. That is why it's a very important creative technique employed by the poets, the travel. But then, even in the Raghuvamsha, there is travel of Raghu, and there's a flight back of Rama and Sita from Sri Lanka to Ayodhya. Travel is there, but there is absolutely no physical travel in the epic Kumarasambhavam. It is the spiritual travel. It is the graduation of Parvati from the material to the spiritual. It is her inward journey. So the travel here is of a different kind, of a more subtle kind. It's not right to call it travel, it's just a spiritual journey or something like that. So it's very difficult to concentrate on just one person as the hero, just one person of the as the heroine, and in a restricted geographical expanse, and write a Mahakavya. That's the beauty of Kumarasambhava. And the other aspect is, we know that Mahabharata has more than 1 lakh shlokas. Ramayana has around 25,000, 24,000 shlokas. Kumarasambhava has 8 sargas, and in total, around less than 800 shlokas for sure, between 700 and 800 shlokas are there. None of the shlokas, none of the verses in Kumarasambhava can be put away. Each one is important. Not just the shlokas, each phrase, each letter is so calculated and so well chosen and so neatly knit. It is like Ganesh has been saying, and like I mentioned today morning, it's like a sculpture of Belur, where every ornament, every intricate detail adds to the beauty. Nothing is extraneous, nothing is unnecessary. Everything is part of a beauty, everything is assisting the beauty. Easily, there are several unnecessary or verses which can bring a kind of boredom in Mahabharata. The 25,000 verses can be condensed easily to 5,000 verses without losing the story and still getting the beauty. Our friend, like Ganeshji was mentioning, H.A. Vasuki, is trying to make a condensed but beautiful edition of Mahabharata. So that is definitely possible for an epic like Mahabharata and an epic like Ramayana, and also for Odyssey and Iliad, that's possible. But for Kumarasambhava, there is no condensation possible. It is beautiful as it is. It is absolutely reduced. There is nothing more that can be done. It is like the ashes on the body of Shiva. It is something that can't be reduced further. That is how it is. So the journey, he hasn't taken a big geographical canvas nor a big time canvas. You know, we see how many years have elapsed in Ramayana or in Raghuvamsa. Several millennia, at least a millennia of time is covered in the Raghuvamsa, and the whole India has been described. But here it is a specific place, which is near the Himalaya. So this is how Kumarasambhava differs from the rest, from the three epics that we are going to talk about. And there is nothing much we know about Kalidasa. All of us, what we know about him are from his works. Dr. S.L. Bhairappa, one of the greatest poets, one of the greatest creative writers alive today, a writer from Karnataka, who writes in Kannada but is a pan-Indian, a pan-Asian, a global creative writer who writes novels in Kannada, he said that each of his work is a biographical thing. Each of his work is autobiographical. Similarly, what we know about Kalidasa is only from his works. We know about his tastes, about where he might have been. We infer from Meghaduta and some other works that he could have been in Ujjaini because of the affection and the tender feelings and the beauty of Ujjaini that he has described. He must have been in Ujjaini. And before him, there must have been Basa, Saumilla, Kaviputra, and other great poets. We come to know this again through his own work, and that is his time and his ancestors. And from Raghuvamsa, we infer that he could have been during the golden Gupta age, and he might have been during the Chandragupta, Vikramaditya, Samudragupta, and other kings. So his own works are kind of an autobiography, which give the biographical details, facts, but more than that, they are a value. They tell what his tastes were, what he gave attention to, and what was his life's aim, and how he approached art, and how versatile he was. That is seen through his works. And in versatility, while speaking about versatility, it's not just epics that Kalidasa has written. Two very great epics he has written, Raghuvamsa and Kumarasambhava. He has also written three plays, the Malavikagnimitram, the Vikramorvashiyam, and Abhijnana Shakuntalam, like we know. So Aristotle in one place says, although it's not very right, a play is more entertaining than an epic. So in one day, in one night, it can be seen. And Kalidasa himself says, Natyam bhinna ruchair janasya bhuta pyekam samaradhanam. For people of different tastes, natya, a theatrical presentation, it caters to people of different tastes. One could be learned, one could be lay, one could be interested in music, the other could be interested in dance, one could be interested in poetry, somebody in Aharya, somebody in the lighting and everything. Today evening we'll be seeing Nirupama's theatrical productions. So there is beauty in every aspect there. So Kalidasa has identified that, and he has written three plays. And he has also written shorter poems like the Meghaduta and the Rutusamhara, which can be read in one sitting or two sittings or something like that. And to read an epic, it needs a different kind of conditioning and culturing of mind and a higher level of appreciation. Although Natya can be appreciated by both the lay and the learned alike, epic needs a different kind of mentality to appreciate. One should be able to comprehend the vast expanse, the epic dimensions. It's not a three-dimensional thing, it's an n-dimensional thing. So he has written all of this, and A.R. Krishna Shastri, a very good aesthetician, a creative writer who was in the early 20th century, he says, an epic, like Ganeshji already quoted this example twice in his talks already, an epic is like a gold mine. There are several rugged rocks, but there is gold hidden there. You need to remove the rugged rocks to actually get hold of the gold. And what is a play, what is a natya? You need to extract that gold from the gold mine. The epic is a gold mine, you have to extract gold. And you just don't give a lump of gold saying that this is natya. You make it into a beautiful image of a god, of something, which gives sublimity. It's not just giving a lump of gold, extracting stories from the epic and giving it as a lump. You give it a beautiful shape. So that is what Kalidasa has done in his Abhijnana Shakuntalam, which I'll elaborate later. So he has been inspired by Vyasa, but he has given his own beauty, he has added his own flavor to the characters, to the incidents, to the story and everything there. So that is the talent of an epic poet who is also a playwright. So he knows both the ends of it. And that also shows his versatility. We don't know if whether Vyasa and Valmiki wrote any plays or whatever. They could have written. We never know. We haven't got any evidence for that. It's likely that they would have written, or they might have just written these epics. That's different. So we know Kalidasa's taste biographical details only through his works. That is all we know. So the story of Kumarasambhava, it's a well-known one. For those of us who don't know, I'll just quickly run through the story. It can just be said in four lines. So Parvati, who was Sati before, the daughter of Daksha, Dakshayani, sacrificed her body in the Dakshayagna, and now she has taken birth as the daughter of Parvataraja, Parvati. Dakshayani has become Parvati, and she wants to marry Shiva. And at the same time, there is this Tarakasura, Taraka, a Rakshasa, who has taken liberty with the cosmic order. So what does this basically mean? Kalidasa himself says, Jagat of Pitarov Vande, Parvati Parameshwarov. So Mata and Pita of the Jagat, of the world, of the cosmic order, are Shiva and Parvati. If the mother is dead and the father has gone to perform tapas or whatever, what will happen to the family? The family is his world. So the cosmic order is ruptured. So that is personified in Tarakasura. So what he has ruptured the cosmic order. There is no dharma and all that. We'll go into the details, what has happened. And so the people, the devatas, they go to Brahma, who is the creator of everything. So they want something new to be created, they go to the creator. So they go and tell about all the evils that Taraka has created. And what they want is a senani, they want a leader to lead them and fight against Tarakasura. So Brahma says, I am not able to create it, I can tell you how to get someone like that. So he says, Dakshayani has taken birth as Parvati, you go to her, and when she marries Shiva, the child born out of the two can be the one who will lead you, Subramanya, who is an amalgamation of both Kshatra and Brahma, Brahma is the intellectual skill and Kshatra is the executive capability. Execution of ideas is Kshatra. The fighting, zeal and the valor, that is Kshatra. And Brahma is the intellectual ability. A similar thing is seen in Krishna. He is the Brahma Kshatra Samahara. That is why the work of Vyasa is so great. He had the intellectual ability, he was an able ruler, and he was able to execute it very well. We have seen that in Chanakya, we have seen that in Vidyaranya. So similarly, it was for this purpose that Subramanya was to be born, to lead them and bring the thing into cosmic order. So how should he be born? By the union of the Jagat of Pitarau, by the parents of the world. They need to get reunited, and from them he needs to be born. So Parvati has been already told that she should marry Shiva. Narada has come and told her father that you should send Parvati to serve Shiva. She has been serving him. And at the same time, Indra comes to know from Brahma that it is through the union of Shiva and Parvati that Subramanya can be born. So what Indra thinks is that this union I can bring about by sending Kama, which is Manmatha. He thinks it is a material union between the two, between Shiva and Parvati. He doesn't realize that it is a spiritual union that needs to take place, not a material union. So Indra calls Kama, which is Manmatha, the Cupid, and says that you go there. He is the one who unites two people. Manmatha goes, and Parvati is also serving Shiva. She thinks she can win over Shiva through her external beauty. And the manifestation of Parvati's external beauty, the physical manifestation, is Manmatha, who is then embodiment of desires. So she goes there, and Manmatha, while she is serving Shiva, Manmatha shoots an arrow, and Shiva wakes up and he burns him. So it's, and Parvati then learns that it's not through my external beauty that I can win over him. It's through my spiritual journey. So Kama should not, the manifestation of Kama through Artha is the ornamentation or the physical beauty of Parvati. It's not through an external manifestation of Kama that is required. It's an inward journey. It should be an Atma Kama. That is what Parvati realizes. Realizing her own self, her own Atma Saundarya, that is the title of the presentation Nirupama is going to do tomorrow. Realizing Atma Saundarya is nothing but realizing Shiva. Her Atma is no different from Shiva. This is the spiritual journey she needs to embark on. So this transition of Parvati from the material to spiritual is seen, and she does the tapas. She was born in a very rich family. She is Anantaratna Prabhavasya Yasya. Such was her father, who had all the treasures with him. She was born in such a family, and she performed hard tapas. And Shiva was impressed by that. And he comes and tests her if she has really progressed from the physical to the spiritual. He comes and asks her some questions in the form of a brahmachari. She qualifies, and Shiva is ready to get married. And he sends the Saptarishis to have a dialogue with Parvati's father, who is Parvataraja, and he agrees. And they get married. So the 7th sarga of Kumara Sambhava is about their marriage, and the 8th sarga is the honeymoon of Shiva and Parvati. So there ends Kumara Sambhava. We don't know if Kalidasa stopped writing there, whether he died in between, or whether we have lost the rest of the work, we don't know. But that is a meaningful pause. It's a meaningful comma that Kalidasa has put. After all, when Shiva and Parvati are united, cosmic order is restored. That is suggested anyway. And Subramanya will be born, and all that will happen is suggested. So it ends with the honeymoon of Shiva and Parvati, Kumara Sambhava. There have been later interpolations and elaborations by poets who have written the rest of the 8 sargas, thinking that it should be completed. But it doesn't have the poetic beauty of the first 8 sargas. So that is the structure of Kumara Sambhava. So we'll start going to the text directly. So the beauty of Indian literature is not in the stories, it's in the detail. This is just a plain story, it's just a 10 lines story. But what is the beauty here? We are going to examine that. So Kalidasa has no invocatory verse at all in Kumara Sambhava. He has one invocatory verse in the Raghuvamsha. He has one for three plays. There is no invocatory verse for Kumarasambhava. That is probably because the theme itself is sublime. The theme itself is divine. What do you mean need more divine than the divine couples, which is Shiva and Parvati? In the rest of, in Raghuvamsha, he has Vagartha Viva Samprukta Vagartha Pratipattaye Jagatav Pitarav Vande Parvati Parameshwarav. It is about some other topic. So he'll do a benedictory verse on Parvati and Shiva. And the three plays are about a royal king and Apsara, the romance between two people. So he feels the need of giving a benediction to Shiva and Parvati, or Shiva, just Shiva, who is his ideal. But here, the epic itself is about Shiva and Parvati. What more does he want to do? So probably he felt that every verse he has written here is a stotra for Shiva, probably. So there is no benedictory verse here to start with. So he starts with the following verse. Astyuttarasyam dishidevatatma himalayo nama nagadhi rajaha purvaparau toya nidhi vagahya stitas prithivyam ivamana dandaha. So the very first word is asti, of confidence. It is there. What is there? Uttarasyam dishi, in the northern direction. There is devatatma. He doesn't say the mountain. We say the in English, in how do I translate this into English? This is the intranslatability I was talking about today morning. We don't call it the mountain. It is devatatma. It can be seen in two ways. Himalaya is the atma of the devas, or the atma of Himalaya is the devas. Sublimity at both the ends. Himalayo nama nagadi rajaha na gachati iti nagaha. What doesn't move, what is stable, that is naga, na gachati iti. Adi raja, the king of the mountains, lives in the northernmost portion of what? Of the land. Purva paro toyanidhi vagahya. On the east and the west, there is toyanidhi, which is always moving, which is always chanchala, which is cool and calm. Purva paro, on the east and the west. Stitav prithivya iva mana dandaha. So what's the magnitude? He said the spiritual magnitude as devatatma. What is the physical magnitude of Himalaya? It is prithivya iva manadandaha. If you want to measure the length and breadth of prithvi, which is the bhumi, you will have to use the Himalaya as a measuring stick, as a measuring device. That is what he says. So here, he has actually started with a big canvas. He has talked about the north, he has talked about the west and the east. Three directions are said, and the fourth one is implied. The southern direction is implied. So he has taken a big canvas, and as we move further, he converges. He goes to smaller and smaller places. He telescopically converges. We see in a telescope, so we are able to see all the stars. Then we concentrate on a constellation. Then we go into one particular planet or something, then into the details of a planet. That is how his poetry has been. That is how he explores it. So the dik, after all, denotes the space. Space has been denoted in the very first geographical expanse. So what is he saying? So anantaratna prabhavasya yasya. So it was full of riches and all that. So this is the Parvata Raja. And he got married to a lady called Mena, who talking about her qualities. Sa manasim mersakas pitrunam kanyam kulasya stitaye stitignyaha Mena muninam apimananiyam atmanurupam vidinopayeme. So he says, so we are talking about Kumara Sambhava, the birth of Kumara. Kalidasa is starting with the marriage of their grandparents from the mother's side. Shiva doesn't have parents. He is Anadi Ananta. He doesn't have any parents. Parvati had a set of parents, which are the Parvata Raja and Mena. So how was Mena? She was Muninam Api Mananiyam. We are always happy when a great person approves our being, approves of our birth. So she was someone who was acknowledged and appreciated by Munis. So it was such a person whom he married, and Atmanurupam, who was totally fitting to him spiritually and emotionally, that she he married Mena. And they had a daughter, they had a son named Mainaka. It was said in the past that the mountains could fly. They had wings. And there's a fable why Indra cut their wings with his thunderbolt. When this process was going on, Mainaka went and hid in the Samudra, which we encounter in Ramayana. He went and hid in the Samudra. So he's the only mountain with wings. So he was born. And then Parvati was born. So in that verse, he says, she who was the daughter of Daksha, she was insulted by Daksha, and she wants a change of parenthood. So she is dead there and comes as the daughter of Parvataraja, who was Dakshayini, comes as Parvati. And she was born as Parvati. What more? So, tam Parvati tyabhijanena tam Parvati tyabhijanena namna bandhu priyam bandhu jano juhava umeti matra tapaso nishiddha paschadumakyam sumukhi jagama. So, initially, by her relatives and friends, she was identified as the daughter of Parvata, Parvati. She was given the paternal name, daughter of Parvataraja. Then later, she got the name, she achieved the name Uma from her mother. So this Uma comes in a later context when she goes into this austerity, this hard austerity of tapas. Her mother says, Uma. So that is like, don't do such difficult tapas. You are such a soft and delicate girl. There are so many gods in our house. Why do you want to go and worship somebody called Shiva? All that she says, and it is her emotional expression of the mother which became a name of Parvati. Instead of being just identified with the father, just because of birth, this is an emotional attachment that her mother added, and that became her name later on. And Kalidasa doesn't stop at this. We have heard several stories about how Subramanya and Ganesha have played and all that, how Krishna has been playing. Imagine the Mata, the Jagan Mata playing. What would have been her play? How would she have played? Mandakini saikata vedikabhi sahakandukai kutrima putrikaischa reme muhur madhyakata sakhinam krida rasam nirvashitiva balye. So what she did, Mandakini, on the banks of the river Mandakini, she created artificial dolls using the sand and the mud on the banks of Mandakini. She created them, and with her sakis, she started playing with that. Kutrima putrikaischa, the motherhood is seen there already. That's so natural to any girl. Here she has the kutrima putra. Yeah, dolls are treated as babies. This aspect of motherhood is seen from her childhood itself. So that happened. And she got all the knowledge as though something that has been learnt in the past life. Prapedire praktana janma vidyaha. As though there was some subconscious awareness of all of these, which has been acquired from her last birth. She got everything. She had taken only a new bodily form, but the content had been passed on from her previous life. And similarly, he goes on to describing her beauty and several things. In one place, he says, is it the ornaments that decorated her body, or did she decorate the ornaments? We say that when people wear ornaments, when humans wear ornaments, it is the ornaments that add beauty to the people. So in case of Parvati, he keeps it as an open question. Is it the ornaments that are adding beauty to her, or is she adding a beauty to the ornaments? And there were, of course, deer and several other animals in the vicinity. So, taya gruhi tam tu mruganga nabhyaha, tato gruhi tam tu mruganga nabhi. So, did she give her beauty, the lotus-like eyes? Did she get the beauty of the eyes from the deer, or did she give it to them? This is the question he raises in the first canto, and later in the fifth canto, we know that we come to know the reality, which I'll be probably covering tomorrow. And how was she created? There are several verses that describe the beauty of Parvati and her activities and all that. Why did and how did the Brahma create her? Sarvopama dravya samuchayena yatha pradesham viniveshitena sa nirmita vishvasruja prayatnat ekasta saundarya didrikshayeva. So here's Vishvasruja. Brahma has created the world, the entire world. And he has created aspects of beauty in different places. But now he wanted to see what would happen if all the aspects of beauty gets concentrated in one place. So Vishwa, prayatnena, with hard attempt, he did it. And probably he was successful, as the poet shows that. He is the one who has created the world, Vishwa, the expanse. And here concentrated in one person, the whole universe. Exactly, yeah. Yes, yeah. Exactly, yeah. So like Ganesh ji said it, that's it. Yeah. That's how Brahma created her. This is what the poet says. Then once Narada, we know Narada is the one who told for the first time the story of Ramayana to Valmiki. It is similarly Narada who plays a slightly important role here. He was roaming around. He saw this lady, such a beautiful lady. Then he had an intuition and he knew that she is the one who is going to marry Hara. And this is what he told his father. Samadhi deshaika vadu bhavatrim premna sharirardha haram harasya. She doesn't just become the wife. She is going to occupy half of his body. So there'll be no dvaita there. It's not two people getting united. Both of them are going to become one, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. To put it in a slightly lighter way, it's not that Parvati stole Shiva's heart. In the Ardhanarishvara, on the left side is the heart. So the heart is in Parvati herself. So she is the master there. She is that of the emotion. So premna, sharirardha haram harasya, with her love, with her emotion, she is going to win over Shiva with her spiritual journey. So this is what Narada said. Then Parvataraja, he doesn't want to go and approach by himself. He doesn't want to approach Shiva by himself and ask for his hand for his daughter and get him married. So what he thinks it, ayachitaram nahi deva devam adrasutam grahitum shashasa. He didn't want to go unasked. He had the fear of being rejected. That is what we all have, in fact. The fear of being rejected, the fear of failure. That is what bothered the Adri Raja also. Although he is so stable, although he is so high, this human emotion is what bothered him. Bharata, okay, deviating a bit again, in his Natya Shastra says, so Brahma created the Natya and he gave the theory to Bharata. And Bharata asks, who are the capable people to execute it? So Brahma says, it should not go to the Devas. Devas know only pleasure. So they don't know the other eight bhavas at all. If they know only sukha, how can they enact human emotions? It should not go to the Devas. And it should not go to the Rakshasas either. They have a biased view about everything. They have a colored vision. If I wear green colored glasses and look at the world, everything would look green to me. I must have a transparent glass, like Ganeshji was mentioning in the first day. I must have a selfless view to be able to appreciate bhavas, to elevate them to the level of rasas. And it can't be mere humans either, because we'll get carried away by bhava, by raga and dvesha. It should be someone more matured than human, but human. They must not be indifferent to human emotions, but they must have a sense of detachment to human emotions. That is the significance of a muni. So Brahma instructed, Brahma gave it to Bharata Muni, in fact, which was later spread to the world. And like we saw in Ramaji's presentation yesterday, she said she wanted her animals to act as humans. So it's humans everywhere. Even the animals should get elevated to the level of humans. The gods should get demoted to the level of humans to make it meaningful. So it's not just animals and gods. It's even the nature where we personify them as human beings and see emotions in them. So we see the emotion in Parvataraja. So what he did was, he sent his daughter, Parvati, to serve Shiva. So what was he? How was he? Sa krittivasas tapase yatatma. Now this is the description of Shiva. So we know from the previous story what should have come as a prelude to this is the Daksha Yajna, which I want to say something. They have a great loss that has happened. Ganesh ji had written a Mahakavya, something of a Mahakavya dimension called Daksha Yajna during his engineering days. Right? And his mother was angry with him that he is writing only poems and not studying for his engineering exam. So he just tore them apart and threw them away. And I don't know, we should only request him to rewrite it. So the Daksha Yajna should have been the prelude to Kumarasambhava. So Dakshayini has taken the birth of as Parvati here, but Shiva has not married another one yet. He has patis pashunam aparigrahobhut. He hadn't even entered into relationships with anyone. He had been pashunam pati only. He had been the master of only the worlds and the animals, not of any other lady. So he was in that manner, and he was doing his tapas. Sa krittivasas tapase yatatma ganga pravaroha ganga pravahokshi hokshita devadaru prastam himadre mruganabi gandhi kinchit kinchit kanat kindara mudivasa. So there he was doing tapas. To do tapas, he had chosen a place which had cool breeze due to the Ganga flowing, and it was a fragrant breeze due to the devadarus that was there, and Mruganabhi Gandhi was there, a fragrant breeze, and there was the beautiful music of kinnaras. In the beginning itself, like I was saying, personification of objects. Yaf purayan kichaka randra bhagan dhari mukottena samiranena. Kinnaranam tala pradayitvam ivopagantum. So he has equated the Himalaya to the Parvataraja to a flute player. So through his cave mouth, he blows air, and they go through the holes of the vamsha, the bamboo, which is, that is how vamshi has come. What has come from vamsha is vamshi. So through those holes, the air goes, and Himalaya is a flutist. So it is in this environment where the kinnaras are playing music, and through for this flute music, they have their thana, they are singing, dancing, there is fragrant air, and there is the cool breeze of Mandakini. In such an atmosphere, Anantaratna, where all the treasures are there he is doing tapas, Shiva. But what are his ganas doing? He might be Krittivasa, wearing just the skin of an animal. His ganas are decorated with the flowers of Nameru, and they have very soft garments of the trees, acquired from the trees, which are soft to touch, and they sit on fragranted asanas. It's not even the harsh soil that Shiva is sitting on. So this is the contrast between the master and his attendants. The master might be realized. The attendants, his attendees might be really silly, and they might be fooling around. That we'll see later on also, when Manmatha comes, how they are playing around. The whole nature is playing around, but only Shiva has been achala there, unperturbed. So this is the situation. The poet asks, Svayam vidhata tapasas palanam kenapi kamena tapaschachara. Why is Shiva performing this penance at all? Why is he doing tapas? He is Svayam vidhata tapasas palanam. He is the creator of the fruits of a tapas. He is not just pradata, he is not just the giver of fruits. He is the creator of fruits. If I do tapas, Shiva doesn't just come and give it. He's not just the giver. He's the one who creates the fruits for different kinds of tapas. So the word vidhata is very specifically and very beautifully used here. And kenapi kamena tapaschachara, like Ganesh was saying, his ashtamurti, the eight forms, he embodies the eight forms, the world, and still he is detached. He has no abhimana from it. When he has everything, he is Ishvara. Aishwarya is his swarupa. When this is there, for what reason would he pray at all? The poet leaves this unanswered. It is for us to contemplate and to get the answer after the study of the kavya, through the study. So, api kena kamena tapaschachara, for what reason? Exactly, that we'll see later. Yeah. Paraspara tapas sampat palayita tapasparo. That is Priyam, that is what Shankara says. The other one was by Appaya Dikshita. It is for this reason that he did tapas. So he doesn't say why he was doing that. So it was under these circumstances that Parvati went to serve him. She got waters for him, she got flowers for him, and aided in his tapas. So I think we can stop here. We are nearing time. There are 3 more minutes. If you have any questions, we can go into it. Maybe I'll need 2 more sessions to... Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, we'll stop for today. And.